Are you ready to start implementing pivot tables inside of your Airtable interface? If so, this video is for you. This feature was just released last week by Airtable with very little fanfare, and I am excited to jump into it here in this video, walk through what it looks like to implement a pivot table for your interface. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Hey, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth, and this is Gap Consulting, where we help you to get the most out of your no-code tools, Airtable being, of course, one of our favorite no-code tools that we use. Now, of course, Airtable is an amazingly powerful back-end, but in this video, we're going to be talking about the front-end components, where if you put together an interface, you can use a pivot table as this newest feature inside of your interface dashboard. But before we get into the heart of the video, I first want to invite you to join me for some free training. If you're new to Airtable, my crash course is going to teach you all the fundamental building blocks of the software so that you can start unlocking its full potential. Go ahead and grab that training at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. You can sign up for free and get that sent to your inbox. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen and we're going to be talking about the new Airtable interface pivot tables. So inside of Airtable, first we need to always talk about our data schema. And for this simple example, I have three tables. I don't necessarily need to have these three tables, but you do at a minimum have to have one table with some information in it. Now, in order to get that information, I turned to ChatGPT. So I went ahead and sent in a prompt and I said, hey, can you just help me create some sample data? I'm looking for sample or example sales data. I need 50 rows of data. And I told it what information I needed in those rows. And then it came back with some information that I didn't think made the best example. So I asked some further follow-up questions saying, hey, I actually only want to have 10 different clients and I only want to include revenue between $500 and $5,000. So I put all that into ChatGPT prompt. It gave me a nice little one-touch download the file, and that simply I was able to then upload that CSV into Airtable. So before we get building any kind of pivot tables, obviously you need some sort of information. So that's what I have here, sample sales data, and I have the client that it's linked to. Remember, clients 1 through 10. I have an amount between 500 and 5,000. I have a date for that, and the date ranges roughly a year from March 2023 to March 2024. And then it's also linked to a service. So if we're looking at the full example here, we've got 10 different clients. You could imagine that I've got client emails, the companies they work for, all of this other information on the client table. And then lastly, I've got a bunch of different services that we offer. And so we could store all that information here as well. So we don't need for these to be linked relationships. I just want to make sure that that's stressed up front. For my example, I wanted them to be, but you don't have to. You could be using single select fields, multi-select fields, whatever. But I have a range of information here, including dates, numbers or currency, and then linked relationships. So let's get into building the interface, the front end. I click on interfaces up here and I'm going to start building. I need to say build an interface, and I can name this first interface whatever I'd like and choose an icon. From here, I'm going to be asked what type of interface I want to build, and at present, these pivot tables are only available for the dashboard. So you have to use the new element of the Airtable dashboard. It used to be that there was a different or a pre-existing dashboard. This has been updated as of, I want to say, early Q1 of 2024. So depending on when you're watching this video, bear that in mind. You're going to be looking for the dashboard, but it sounds like Airtable will be rolling pivot tables out to other interface types. Right now, it's just dashboard. Don't quote me on this. I have no control over when they allow it to go to other types of dashboard layouts. So for now, if you want it, it's got to be here at the dashboard level. We're going to go ahead and sign on in here. Now, another thing I want to point out is if you're trying to access your interface via your mobile device, pivot tables, they're not going to be supported on mobile yet. It's got to be desktop. All right, so let's go ahead and move into the next one where we're choosing the table that we want to analyze on our dashboard. Now for us, that's going to, of course, be where we are storing our sales data. That is the relevant table for us, so we keep it on that. And then we're gonna say finish, because on the next page here, this is where we are editing that interface so that we can, you know, update it to our heart's content. So right here, you'll see that by default, given the data that I started with, this is what it's giving me. So I have an untitled section here. I have my description or page, I should say. And then I've got two big elements here. I've got the count. So I have 50 records. If you recall, that's exactly how many rows of data I asked ChatGPT for. So of course it's showing me that. Okay, maybe I need that in my dashboard. And it also has a graph that really doesn't make any sense whatsoever, right? This graph not particularly valuable for my users, because it's just a bunch of sales data organized by the amount on the x-axis. So it's kind of funny to look at. Now, I can just remove this element because it's not really relevant for what I'm doing here. What I want to highlight is that if I hover over the right part of this, you'll notice that this whole section is now highlighted. This is called a group inside of the interfaces. And if I click, when I have the entire thing selected like that, I can pick add to group. So I can just boom right here. Now that I've selected the group, add a new element inside of this. And here's where I have a bunch of different options. So here are my numbers. I already have that. I've got bar charts, pie charts, line charts, all the charts, right? We've had these for a while. I can do lists and timelines. We've had these for a while, but now you'll see pivot table. So let's say I want to drop a pivot table in here. You'll notice that it's now added. See this dotted line here? The pivot table is part of this group. So this whole section right here in my page is called the group, and I now have a pivot table. Okay, so let's get into the pivot table itself. First thing, title. So we can always come back here and update this later, which I will do once we've actually set up a working pivot table. We can also add a description here. We'll take care of that in a moment. We can apply filters. The filters is on top of the back end. So we have 50 rows of data that we're going to analyze. If we wanted to say only look at stuff that was in the year 2024, we could apply a filter. We could say, hey, look, for this particular pivot table, I only want to look at stuff where the date is on or after, and then we could pick, you know, January 1st of 2024. And now all the data that we see is going to be filtered by this filter that we apply right here. Now, I don't want that. I want all 50 rows of data, but you need to understand that you can apply a filter to your pivot table so that it only brings in the stuff that you need for that particular section. Okay, for us, what do we want to see? Well, we can see our services, let's say, and maybe we want to look at the sales amount that we have secured, but by service and also by date. So this is kind of the power of a pivot table. We can choose the row. So we're doing some sort of grouping or some sort of sort by row, and then we're also going to do it on the columns, and then we can apply some sort of function to the number inside of that cross section. So for us, we might say, all right, look, we've got 10 different services. We have it over a range of 12 months. I want to see sales in a pivot table so that we can look at total sales based on service, based on when we sold it, and there just analyze that in a table. If that's a little hard to understand, by the time we're done building this, you're going to be blown away. So first things first, is our services. That's gonna be on the rows. So for the rows side, we're gonna pick the field and we're gonna come on down and say, well, we wanna group this by service. That's what we want to analyze right here. And so you'll now see that we've stacked by service. Now, it's sorted by the group currently, but we could also sort it by a value. And if we sort by value, then it's going to rearrange this information based on the data that's showing up in the table here. That doesn't quite make a lot of sense just yet. So let's finish setting up everything here. But for our example, I want it to be on group. Next, I want my columns across the top to be date. Yes, I want to look at this by date. But you'll notice that with date, I have another option here. I can bucket by date. So maybe I want to look at stuff in a week by week basis or a month over month basis. This is an amazing feature that Airtable has right out of the box, anytime we're analyzing date data. So by breaking this down right here, we can then see like, okay, here we go. We've got 2023. This is March. Here's April. Here's May, et cetera, et cetera. Again, we're going to come back to this value versus group in just a moment. Lastly, though, we need to talk about the appearance. What's actually going into these cells? Where these things are overlapping, where we have a service that meets with a particular month in this case, what do we want to see? Well, we want to see sales data. So not a count, not the number of times that records appear in that cross section. No, we want to see the field. The field that we want to look at is the amount. And we want to look at the sum. But notice that we have a lot of options here. If we're dealing with currency like we are, we can deal with sums, averages, medians, mins, max, range, standard deviation, all kinds of stuff. So however we want to slice and dice our data, available right here in this section. Now, the last component here is going to be the size of the pivot table. You'll notice that we can't really drag and expand this section. I don't have the ability to grow it and, you know, drag it around. I can only reposition it inside of the group. So how do we do it? Well, it has to do with this button back here. So back here in under appearance, we're looking at the size. So for us, medium, let's see, does that fit? That fits up pretty well. All right. Now, one thing I'm noticing here is that because I've got 12 months across the top, I'm not seeing my data in an actionable way because I want to make sure, at least for my preference, when I'm looking at a pivot table, I want the sum of both the rows and the columns to be showing up. And right now I only see the columns here on this, but the rows, I have to scroll all the way to the side in order to see. So maybe I want to group this differently, maybe not by month, but by quarter, thereby condensing it to four different columns, making it a little bit easier to see. And there's my sum, all of it available right here. Now I mentioned that we would go back to this. So now that we have these numbers here, we're able to see it by quarter across the columns and by service across the rows, how many sales we did in that section, that cross section. So this implies that we did almost $4,000 worth of service five in the second quarter of 2023. Now, service five didn't sell anything in the third and the fourth quarters of 2023. And then in first quarter 2024, we saw more sales. So quickly and easily, we can see our total service sales here, and then our total quarter sales down here, and then our total sales across all quarters and all services in the very bottom right. Going back to the idea of the value now, let's look at our service here. Right now we've grouped by the service, which doesn't really do much of anything except for put this in alphabetical order, given the way that we set up our structure. But we can apply value. And so when we do this, what it's going to do is actually rank these services in order. So the smallest value for our service sales in totality here is 6,200. Well, that's putting service 10 up at the top. So this is really valuable to you if you're analyzing sales data or some sort of click-through rate or opt-in or any kind of metric that you're trying to drive an increase on. You can use the value function to really get an understanding. Now, if we're sorting by order, we can put the biggest number at the top or the biggest number at the bottom, determining whether we're going ascending or descending. That's pretty straightforward stuff. The last remaining piece to add, though, is the user actions that you as the interface builder have at your disposal. So right now it's kind of a little buggy for me. I have to actually be clicked into this element itself before I see all three of the user actions. One way that I've found I've been able to do this easily is to toggle this off and then to toggle it right back on. Again, I don't know if that's a bug or not. They might be working to improve this part, but when I toggle it off and then back on, I'm able to see that I have these three options. So the first one is, can users click in to see the underlying record data? And so right now I have this toggled on, and what that means is they can hover over here and maybe they want to see, well, what did we sell? Because here we have the cross section of quarter two in 2023 with service seven. Well, what did we sell? If I click in, if I allow the users to click in, it opens on a side panel here and shows me, oh, look, check it out. We have these two different services that we sold, both for right around $3,400. And that's how we get that total of $6,900. Cool. All right. So that's the first component. Now, you might already be asking, am I able to change the way this appears right here? Now, to the best of my knowledge, not at this time. This might be updated in the future, but right now I'm kind of stuck, at least as far as I've been able to explore. I'm stuck with this looking this way. I can't change what's visible in this record. It's just showing me this information. Okay, so that's part one. Now, the second user action is allowing them to click into the record details. Now, of course, this is dependent upon the fact that you're letting them see the underlying records. But maybe you want them to be able to click into this specific record as well and open it up. Well, we can either say allow from right here or just toggle this on right here. And then we can also choose what this layout looks like. This is a record detail where we're diving into one specific record that we've selected. And with just a simple click now, we're able to empower our users. So first they click into that section, then they click into that record, and they get a deep dive on that specific record's data. Now, the last component down here is allowing users to print. So if we want them to be able to print from their screen and to print the page, we can toggle that on, keep that on. Once we're happy with these changes, let's publish our interface. Don't forget to share it. You'll be prompted on the next screen. And here it is. Now, I do want to highlight for you that if we go back to the dashboard, it seems like there's two layers here. Here is the dashboard, the interface dashboard itself, and then we click into it to expand this information. We don't have to necessarily click into it because we can just hover over here and open up any of these sections, and you'll notice that we have now been taken into it, and we can now expand the information in the record, and we can even print it because that's how we set it up inside of our interface. If we need to make changes, of course, we can go back to editing our interface. And as I mentioned earlier, now that we have this all set up, we can name it properly. So we can say sales totals by quarter and service. And we could write a nice colorful description as well. Hey, I know we went pretty fast in this video. Obviously, there's a lot to cover, but pivot tables are not a new concept. They've been around in spreadsheets for ages, but I'm hopeful now that you're able to take your data even further inside of Airtable interfaces. Any questions that we did not address, be sure to drop them below wherever you found this video. And in the meantime, my friend, keep on building.